Joining us now is Ojinika Okpe with stories trending around the world. Hello, Jinix.
You don't know what to do again.
He doesn't know.
Good morning. How are you?
I'll tell you later.
How are you? I love the way we all laugh in the morning. How are you this morning?
Should I tell you now? I can't.
No need.
Tell him. Good morning, Rafai. How are you? Very well.
Ojinika, you see?
It's magic, isn't it? Well, all right. Good morning to you, viewers. Here are some of the stories that are trending across the globe.
In the United States, Ketanji Brown Jackson is officially becoming a justice nearly 3 months after she won confirmation to the Supreme Court. The 51-year-old will be sworn in as the court's 116th justice today. While in Afghanistan, the Taliban on Wednesday banned women from participating in large gatherings organized to address issues of national unity in a conscious effort by the Taliban government to trample on women's rights since they took over power in August 2021. In France, 32-year-old Salah Abdel Salam, the lone survivor of a team of Islamic State extremists who terrorized Paris in 2015, was convicted on Wednesday of murder and other charges and sentenced to life in prison without parole for the deadliest peacetime attacks in French history. Abdel Salam was convicted with 19 other men involved in the public assault in Paris that killed 130 people and injured hundreds. In Nigeria, the Senate on Wednesday resolved to dispatch a delegation to the United Kingdom over the case of organ harvesting involving the country's former Deputy Senate President, Ike Ikwerimadu, and his wife, Beatrice.
A delegation from the Senate Committee on Foreign Affairs of the Senate will leave in the next 2 days to London for that purpose.
Under sports, a leaked audio clip of Real Madrid defender Sergio Ramos asking the head of the Spanish Football Federation, Luis Rubiales, to help him win the 2020 Ballon d'Or has surfaced online. The audio clip was reportedly recorded between July and August 2020, ahead of the Ballon d'Or award, which was later canceled due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Finally, under entertainment, disgraced R&B superstar R. Kelly was sentenced to 30 years in prison on Wednesday for using his fame to sexually abuse young fans, including some who were just children, in a systematic scheme that went on for decades. The 55-year-old Grammy-winning singer and songwriter was found guilty last year of racketeering and sex trafficking. He has denied wrongdoing and plans to appeal his conviction.
Oh, all right. Tunde Abiola, justice at last, especially for those women who never thought that they will get justice. I was watching earlier this morning about this young woman who went to his concert at the age of 17, and she kept silent. She never knew she was going to get justice. I mean, this man, huge superstar, life wasted. But they're also, the prosecutors are saying that he was abused as a young man.
Yes.
I'm not sure if that's enough excuse for what he's done.
It's not an excuse.
It's not enough excuse for what he's done. But, you know, he also has other charges, especially one in Chicago now.
Yes, he was abused, like you said, but so was his brother. And his brother did not grow up to be an abuser. And he was also abused financially. This is R. Kelly, because he's barely literate, so he was taken advantage of, and all of that is really tragic, but that does not give you the right to treat people the way he did. I mean, it's the details of the horrendous crimes he committed against children most of the time. Kids, what he did to them. Were you able to watch that Surviving R. Kelly?
No, I
couldn't watch it. I tried. I couldn't sit through it. It was too distressing what he did. So this 30-year sentence, I'm sorry, it is in order. He deserves that. And it also helps enablers of powerful people, of rich people, to understand that you are actually doing the entire world, including the person you think you're protecting, a huge disservice if you do not report them quickly. Because he was enabled for decades.
Absolutely.
He was the kind of deviant behavior that he's now been convicted of permitting. Mm-hmm. And it's another thing. Look at Giselle.
That's what I was going to say.
20 years. Yeah. Sex trafficking is no joke. And that signal has been sent loud and clear. Yes. And I'm so glad.
That point you made, there was that juxtaposition of her sentencing and R. Kelly's sentencing. A lot of people are saying that, you know, her sentencing was too low. People were even playing the racial card, Dr. Abati, with, you know, with Gayleen and R. Kelly.
Robert Sylvester Kelly. He got away in 2018 when he was charged for child pornography. Mm. And this time around, he's not getting away with it. Although he continues to claim no wrongdoing, and maybe his lawyers will go on appeal. He's 55, 30 years in prison, I mean, except he gets a parole at some point. You know, this is effectively at the end of his career, a career that was otherwise outstanding in terms of individual achievement and also in terms of talent and what he represented. Now, you said everything has disappeared. I always say it on this program that artists are not necessarily good people. Mm. Even when they fail, they're survived by their art and their contribution. So that contribution may be in a safe place. Mm. But he, as an individual, you know, has become an example of how not to live recklessly.
Yes.
The judge, the U.S. District Judge, Anna Donnelly, talked about the horror that your victims endured. Child trafficking, child pornography, turning young girls into sex slaves. And this, indeed, is a triumph, a victory, well-deserved, for those women who decided to speak up. And also for the Me Too, hashtag Me Too movement. You know, the hashtag Me Too movement a few years back was quite, you know, a major thing. And again, it also proves the point that nobody is above the law.
Absolutely.
Ghislaine Maxwell, the two sentence Maxwell sentencing, Kelly sentencing, the same week, you know, will be a very strong reminder to the women out there that, in fact, when you speak up, justice is possible.
Well said, Dr. Abati. Rufai, quickly comment.
Another true Hollywood story, isn't it?
Yes.
This is a man that sang so much about saving people and saving the world. This is the man that said, "I believe he can, I can fly," but he clipped the wings of others from flying. This is a man that gave so much hope to a lot of people, but he gave hopelessness to his victims. This is a man of many parts, but indeed, he gave destruction and pain to a lot of people. It just shows you that no matter how much you hide, the long arm of the law will catch up with you someday. But most importantly, I think one thing that will rest with R. Kelly is his conscience. And guess what? That thing called conscience is an open wound.
Absolutely. Well said, Rufai.
Let it be remembered by everyone that the last line in Sophocles' Oedipus Rex, Oedipus the King, rings true. Let no man call himself happy until he carries that happiness to the grave in peace. Mm.
Yeah. Anything classic, can happen.
Classic tragic story. And that's why we all have to be careful.
Absolutely. We'll take our story in Nigeria. With reactions trailing comments made by a former governor of Ekiti State, Ayodele Fayose, who on Wednesday demanded that a southerner must succeed President Muhammadu Buhari in 2023. Fayose, who is a member of the People's Democratic Party, was one of the presidential hopefuls that contested the primary of the opposition party. Taking to Twitter, the former governor wrote in Yoruba language the words, "Our South lo kan," which means it is the turn of the South, a reference to the catchphrase attributed to Aṣíwájú Bola Ahmed Tinubu, the presidential candidate of the All Progressives Congress. Let's take some reactions. Well, Oluwa Kore wrote, "This isn't surprising. He's been softly canvassing for Aṣíwájú even before the primaries. He should be told to call Tinubu." The just-concluded election in Ekiti was another indicator. APC coasts to victory because of his role. Fayose and politicians are generally in it for personal interest. Well, Fortunate wrote, "The PDP has already broken the fragile pillar on which it's standing. They've lost relevance from the few who still revered them. This is the lesson that I've learned from this. Don't change the cause of equity and justice because nature will definitely fight back." Well, Distinguished wrote, "No argument, but if it's not the Southeast, then it's not equity or justice. You can't choose half equity. Igbos have never had a vice or president since 1999. You know, the sudden U-turn, obviously, is a shock for a lot of Nigerians. I don't know if it's a shock because it is politics as usual. But a lot of people are also saying that, you know, he's probably, like my first tweet, Twitter user wrote, he's probably also campaigning for Tinubu. And now, you know, he's talking about power shift to the South. I don't know what your thoughts are.
I think he's actually been really consistent. Mm-hmm. He decided to run for president under the platform of PDP, saying that it should go, the presidency should go to the South, which he, of course, he's from. Because I remember him actually saying that the, was it 2018 PDP primary was an all-Northern affair, that one that was held in Port Harcourt, so that this primary this year should have been an all-Southern affair. Mm. That obviously did not happen.
Yeah.
So he has been consistent. I think the issue for me, what I can tell, when he lost at the primary, he did congratulate the presidential candidate, Atiku Abubakar. What this suggests to me then was that he was able to accept his defeat with equanimity, but what he's objecting to is what I'm inferring, the sort of overlooking of Governor Wike as Alhaji Atiku Abubakar's running mate.
Yeah.
I think that's the issue for him. Hmm. He seems to be one of those, like Governor Autumn, who would have preferred Governor Wike. I think PDP would have managed to hold things together, even though, yes, a lot of people wanted a southern presidential candidate from the PDP, especially a southeast presidential candidate from the mm-hmm. PDP, if he had gone with the popular choice of the party, which was Governor Wike. As Governor Autumn told us here yesterday, they had a 17-member committee, 14 chose Governor Wike. So why did Atiku Abubakar, you know, sort of have this departure from their own views? Now, with regards to who he's supporting, I don't think it's an accident that he says, our South Lokon, quoting APC's presidential flag bearer. And I'm wondering, what is the role here of party discipline? Because this is flagrant in terms of, you know, going against the will of your party. Is he now going to defect, like you said, or is he going to stay in PDP while making these disgruntled noises from within the ranks? I'm not sure. But there does seem to be something rotten in the state of PDP. Even look at the Osun campaign. They've kicked off the Osun election campaign. And of how many PDP governors are there? About 12 or 13. Only two showed up. Where is their presidential flag bearer? He's still abroad. Only Governor Okowa and Darius Ishaku showed up for in Osun State. After that, not very good showing in Ekiti State, where PDP came third. I'd have imagined it would be all hands on deck so they don't lose Osun. It appears that there's really something fishy going on in PDP, and Governor Fayose has never been one who to be reticent. He's letting us know that that is in fact the case.
Well, what does that say about Atiku Abubakar at this point, not being even able to unite the party or for people to even support him at this point, Rufai?
It just shows that the PDP is standing on very wobbly legs. And they want to run a marathon. That's the sad reality. There's so many divisions. We can start pointing how fragmented the party is. Governor Tom coming on air yesterday just shows a very big division, line drawn in the middle. A lot of people are disgruntled. And like I said, the PDP should watch it. Fayose is saying, hey, our South to local. Obviously,
local.
You know that's a dog whistle. You know where he's calling people to come.
Mm-hmm.
If I hear he's defected tomorrow, he's not defected. Well, I wouldn't be surprised. Does a Nigerian politician surprise you for anything? Mm-hmm. Nigerian politicians don't surprise me. So it just shows that all is not well in the camp of the PDP. Just like they couldn't summon up all the governors to come together. They didn't even do anything in Ekiti State.
Right.
Now in Osun State, you're saying only two showed up. So as we speak today, and that's why it's a shame that we couldn't get the party spokesperson to come here and talk to us. As we speak today, the PDP is except the people that was. That's my reaction.
All the political parties still have up to about 6-7 months before the election.
Mm.
And the assumption will be correct to say that within that period, there's still a window for reorganization, for negotiations, for dialogue, for appeals. Now, what has been pointed out in the case of the PDP is that trouble started after the primaries. And after the primaries, it will have been a good thing for the candidate that emerged to reach out to the aggrieved governor of River State, Nyesom Wike, who came second, having also been denied the opportunity of deem a running mate as recommended to Alhaji Atiku Abubakar. But you know the politics of that. Clearly, some people don't consider him compatible. Governor Otom was saying yesterday that we know that Wike can be like this, can be like that, you know, but that, you know, that's not the way it works. If he's made the running mate and if he becomes the vice president of Nigeria, he's likely to act in a different manner, knowing that the platform is bigger than where he's coming from in, what's the name of that, their village, Port Harcourt. You know, that this is Nigeria.
Port Harcourt is not a village.
Well, you
know, Port Harcourt is not a village.
No, the garden city.
The garden city of Port Harcourt.
I know.
Stop hate speech.
No, but that's local politics, you know, that he plays. But he will now, if he has been chosen, have to play national politics. So village habits will not, you know, function at the center. That's the kind of excuse that they give. But we are faced with this reality.
Yeah.
So it means that one, the leadership of the party, we just have to bring everybody together. How they go about it will be a test of whether or not the PDP wants to win the 2023 presidential election or not. Second, in 2015, after losing the election, the PDP put a committee together to try to review what happened, to learn lessons. Because in 2014, 2015, the party was just as divided. And it just took a number of governors getting angry and deciding to leave the party. Some of them even formed what they called the new PDP at the time. But there were other persons who stayed within the party to sabotage the party from within. Mm. And hence, you know, the PDP lost in 2015. In 2019, another committee was set up to learn lessons from the 2019 election. What happened? Now, the same crisis of 2015, 2014, 2019 is now what is rearing its head. So there must be, there is a battle for the soul of the party. And the dangerous thing is that it's not only, you can be sure that it's not only Otom that is aggrieved, or Wike, or Fayose. There will be many more people out there. So many of them may not even defect, but they will work against the party from within. And Fayose say,
our South Lokon, quoting
Section 3.6 of the PDP Constitution, mm-hmm. and saying you will get details very soon. Who knows? He may defect, he may not defect, he may stay within the party and work against the party. You know, he may even underground, you know, work for not just our South Lokon, but the Emi Lokon project. Emi Lokon having become a major phrase in the lexicon, in the grammar, rather, of Nigerian politics.
Yes, well.
And you know who is Emi Lokon, who is in the south of France, somebody told me. And then from south of France to Turkey, we're told that, you know. So we'll see how this plays out. Political season is a very interesting season.
Absolutely.
We see a lot of alignments and realignments.
Yes.
But whoever wins, beyond all the permutations, is the interest of Nigerians that should be paramount to us. Who is going to rescue the Naira that has depreciated so badly? Who is going to address the pandemic of empty pockets mm-hmm. that all of us are facing in this country? Who is going to address security? Who is going to make it easy for us to be proud again that we are Nigerians and we will not be having problem with even something that used to unite us, sports, which now is a source of agony, at least in the House of Basketball.
Mm-hmm. Well, all right. We'll take another story. The Nigerian Army on Wednesday disclosed that about 314 suspected members of Boko Haram and the Islamic State West Africa province have surrendered. The terrorists were said to have surrendered to troops in Bama Local Government Area of Borno State as a result of the ongoing onslaught against terrorism in the northeast. The Nigerian Army, which disclosed this on its official social media handle, said the troops also rescued 12 farmers from the terrorist den. According to the statesman, the terrorists are currently being profiled. I mean, there are a lot of questions here, Rufai, with this story. A lot of people are saying, were they without their guns? How did it happen? Was it an invasion? The breaking news that was on their official Twitter handle didn't give specific details as to how these terrorists surrendered.
I think we want more details as to how this terrorist surrendered. Because, you see, we keep having thousands and thousands of terrorists surrendering, but the war is not surrendering.
Mm.
We are not seeing peace. We still have attacks, and we still have... The last time, how many of them is it surrendered with children and
there
women?
There were 7,000.
7,000.
Surrendered.
Last time.
A few months ago, yeah.
But we don't see the effect on the war. So all these people, at least if they are surrendering, we should see a knock-on effect on peace. But we are not seeing it. So that means these people are way more than that. So please, they must furnish us with more information.
Yes.
And they stop saying, you know, it's a security something. No. We want transparency in this country. We want accountability. We want integrity. We keep hearing people are surrendering. By now, the war should be abating. My question is, when will those that kidnap the Kaduna train victims even surrender?
Mm-hmm.
And we can rescue them? Where are we going to have people that did major kidnappings, major bandit group, surrender and say, okay, we surrender all the victims, so then they capture them? We want that. The Chibok girls, when will those that held the Chibok, still hold some of the Chibok girls, surrender?
Mm-hmm.
That we can, the ones that held the Baptist boys, that still hold the Baptist boys now, after a year, when will those ones surrender?
Exactly.
And we capture them. So please, yes, it's a welcome development, but we need more. We need to hear more facts. We need to dig deep.
Absolutely.
And see that this surrendering is having a knock-on effect on the war itself.
Absolutely.
Because we need to end this once and for all.
What was shocking for me was the faces of these young men. I don't know if you... I mean, look at their faces. I cannot believe that these people, you know, are terrorists, Tundu Abiola.
You know, there's somebody sitting on my right that I call a baby-faced assassin.
Yeah.
Oh, really? But these guys, you know...
Go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Baby-faced. Now I have another name for you,
but
Rufai.
They actually give it literal meaning.
Yes.
They look so normal and so decent. It's actually scary. When
yes.
you think of terrorists, you imagine some kind of grotesque... scary individuals. They look really like regular people. It is worrying. So there is something rotten in this as well. That's mm-hmm. actually Hamlet, mm-hmm. Shakespeare's Hamlet. There's something rotten in the state of Denmark. But to the point that you were making, Rufai, yes, 7,000 Boko Haram terrorists were said to have surrendered. And I have to say were said to have surrendered.
Yes.
Because I'm simply not convinced, I'm afraid.
You're
because
not alone,
what happens after this so-called surrender, mm-hmm. what kind of intelligence is gathered such that we haven't seen any real impact on this war against terrorism in this country? We haven't seen the release of any captives. They haven't told people this is what to do, this is where to go. None of that. Mm-hmm. I know according to the Global Terror Index, Nigeria is doing a lot better where the fight against terror stands. But on the other hand, what we call banditry is only growing in strength.
Yes.
So what exactly is the practical impact of this so-called surrender to yeah. us, the Nigerian public? Do you feel safer in your bed at night? Because I certainly don't. And we're having thousands of people surrender. What is the status of this Operation Safe Corridor, where they're given amnesty, they're given money from, you know, taxpayers' money to live their lives and have businesses, whereas internally displaced people are stuck in camps for years on end. So this whole surrender, there are just too many questions around it. And
yeah.
I hate to look a gift horse in the mouth. I'm supposed to be excited,
yeah.
but I'm simply not.
Yeah, talking about their looks again, there was an article I read, Dr. Abati, which states that, you know, if you eliminate the use of tramadol, hard drugs, you will weaken these terrorists. And like you said, they absolutely do not look like terrorists.
If you look at them, you see that majority of them, they are very young people.
They look young, yeah.
So this is a problem we face in this country. An army of young people who have no future, who have been hypnotized, who are living a life of drugs, who have had access to arms and ammunition, and who are causing considerable havoc in their country. Now, and that is why some people have recommended as part of the solution, a holistic approach that will involve education, addressing inequalities and poverty. Beyond that, the second point to be made here is that, look, they say they surrender. Okay, no, the army gives some clarity as to the circumstances of their surrender. They say it was in the course of Operation Adinkai, you know, that the army, they were involved in an operation. Maybe they overpowered them and they surrendered. But having surrendered, the solution is not that we will hear tomorrow that they are already cooking jollof rice for them and that they are planning to give them Ashwebi. As we have seen,
I was waiting for that.
In previous instances, because giving them jollof rice and pepper soup has not solved any problem. They say it's called the rehabilitation reintegration. Many of the people who were rehabilitated, so called, and reintegrated, in fact, went back after a while to the camp. So it's not enough to just say they surrendered. The military authorities should document these people and hand them over to the appropriate authorities and charge them to court for offenses against the state. Mm-hmm. If you begin to charge them to court and hold them responsible for their crime against the Nigerian state, maybe that will be a better deterrence. Mm-hmm. Because these people, the way I'm looking at them, they look like they want jollof rice and pepper soup.
Doctor,
is not working. Mm-hmm. And it must be discarded with forthwith.
At least they are sitting on the floor now, then they are not wearing the green, white, green, and hopefully they won't be eating jollof rice anytime soon.
But they don't look like junkies.
That's what I said. Absolutely not. We shall take our final story. A high court in Port Harcourt River State has sentenced James Imhalu, a dismissed policeman, to death by hanging for the murder of a commercial driver in 2015 over his refusal to pay him 100 Naira bribe. Justice Elsie Thompson, while delivering the judgment, described the former officer as a serial trigger-happy policeman that should not be allowed to remain in society. She said the evidence before the court showed that the former officer intentionally fired the shot that killed the commercial driver. It has been 8 years since the officer killed the driver, identified as Lagbara David. One of the counsel to the prosecution team said the judgment will serve as succor to the deceased family. Justice at last, another story, justice at last. I mean, this is absolutely coming right in order at this point. Unfortunately, we don't have much time to chat on the story. I don't know if you want to make a quick comment before we go.
OJ, I agree with you, justice at last. And people always say these things don't matter. The deceased has gone, you can't bring them back. But it actually does give succor to the family.
Absolutely.
It absolutely does. It gives you closure and a sense that that life was precious and should not have been wasted like that.
All right, then. Well,
okay, I hope that the police authorities will take the picture of James Imhalu, which is the name of the guy, and put it in every police station to remind every policeman who is tempted to be trigger happy of what happens to people like that.
Well,
okay? And there will be no appeal. The legal aid counsel has said so.
Absolutely.
And there will be no appeal.
Absolutely. Well, thank you all for your great analysis. That's all I have for you on What's Trending Today. I'll see you tomorrow.